Now, because one believes, pain does not decrease. But faith can keep one from being incapacitated. To grieve and to cry is common. But we are to rejoice also for the coming day when God promises no more death, no more suffering. Now, rejoicing can coexist with mourning and great loss, but avoid spiritual sounding comments that will just minimize the suffering. On the worst day of his life, Job had his 10 children taken from him. Then he worshiped God. On the worst day of his life, Robert Rogers, his wife Melissa, and their 4 children were in their minivan on their way home from a wedding. This is in Missouri a few years back, when the unthinkable then occurred. There was a flash flood that swept away the van, and everybody in it perished except Robert. As the water rose to the seat cushions, the children in the back began to wake up and their cry. And he says that they did 3 things. First, we said the name of Jesus over and over. Jesus, save us. And he said we were trapped. There was nothing that we could do at this point. The engine had stalled. We couldn't get out of the water. And it was rushing at estimated at 32,000 gallons a second. And it carried away the 4 children. The second thing on our lips was scripture. Went over Psalm 46. God is my strength, my refuge, and ever-present help in time of trouble. And the third was praise. And he says that that was the part that felt most strange. Robert says that Job chose not to sin when he lost his 10 children. Job saw the face of God. And sometimes I feel that I got to touch his hand as he scooped my family up. He gave me a peace. I learned to die to myself, but I didn't die physically. And now it's a story of hope to say God is real. And if you trust him, he will use whatever the circumstances for good. He now goes around talking of hope. So to grieve and cry, it's a common thing. And it's healthy amongst God's people. Look, Paul, he encouraged the Thessalonians. And he also encourages us about our future with Christ. And our loved ones who have died in Christ. And I emphasize in. He writes, we do not want you to be uninformed, brethren, about those who are asleep, so that you will not grieve as do the rest who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep in Jesus. In his first letter to the Thessalonians. Susanna Wesley. Now, everyone applauds her as a great prayer warrior because she prayed for her 2 sons. Yes, she did. John and Charles Wesley. But do you know that 9 of her children died by the age of 2? Put yourself in her place. There's Horatio Spafford. Now, he knew something about life's unexpected challenges. He was a successful attorney, real estate investor, and he lost a fortune there in the Great Fire of Chicago in 1871. And around the same time, his 4-year-old son died of scarlet fever. So thinking that a vacation would do good for his family, he sent his wife and his 4 daughters on a ship to England, planning to join them after he finished some business. But while crossing the Atlantic, the ship was involved in a collision and sunk, and more than 200 people lost their lives, including all four of Horatio's daughters. His wife, Anna, she survived, and when she got to England, she sent a telegram to her husband that began, "Saved alone. What shall I do?" Well, he set sail for England, and well, when they come to the point where his daughters had perished, the ship's captain, aware of the tragedy that struck the Spafford family, summoned Horatio to tell him and show him that they were now passing the spot where the accident had occurred. So as he thought of his daughters, words of comfort came to him. Hope filled his heart. Hope filled his mind. And he wrote down, but listen to these six words. When sorrows like sea billows roll. When sorrows like sea billows roll. Think of what's going through his mind. And he writes, when sorrows. He's no different than you. He's no different than me. But he continues, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to know it is well. It is well with my soul. So however you want to look at the reason for these deaths, God permitted them. And he used Susanna and Horatio, let's just use those two, their profound suffering to make them champions of faith. As many who live with ongoing disabilities and diseases and heartaches, they're aware that God doesn't partial out a certain amount of suffering. And then once part of that is gone or it runs out, then there's no more. No. Of those well known, there's Joni Erickson Tada. Of those not known, there's Rhonda and Tim McGuire. Johnny Zimmerman and Paul Jokers. And then there are those in this small flock. But we, you, all, everyone, can know that the promise of God remains and is as valid now as before. And that brings us to our verse for the day. From Lamentations chapter 3. Though he brings grief, he also shows compassion because of the greatness of his unfailing love. So in closing, I don't know who all saw the movie Slumdog Millionaire, or if you didn't. We can forget for a moment the controversies that are surrounding the violence, the child exploitation. But the story is about a young man's unwavering love for a girl that he meets in the slums. And they're tragically separated for years. And then when they meet again she's taken away. Yet he never stops trying to find her. Well, against all impossible odds, he finds her. And when they're reunited, he pulls back her shawl scarf that women wear in India. And you see a long, capture-inflicted scar that disfigures her face. As she looks down in shame, the young man, you know, tears coming out of his eyes. He holds up her face and he kisses her scar. Not first her lips, but her scar. It's like the scar is now redeemed, and somehow it's made beautiful. So what you get from the story, though, is the depths of their love. And that's the power. Love forged in years of injustice, evil, suffering, and separation. Realize, though, that that climactic love-filled moment could not have happened without the disturbing setting of the story. He could have kissed the scar if she had had no scar. At the climax of this age, Scripture tells us that he will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. God, he couldn't wipe away every tear from every eye without the billions of tears shed because of injustice, because of evil, because of suffering, all that's been endured. Had Jesus not borne it on the cross? Hasn't God kissed your scars? When you look at a crucifix, I don't mean just the cross, I mean the crucifix. When you look at the scars on the hands and the feet and the side of Jesus, shouldn't we, shouldn't you, shouldn't all of us with tears in our eyes wish to kiss them? Be amazed that the Creator, who always was, who with his word created all and brought everything into existence, became a man, died,